So let's get started. It's the final panel is, of course, the highlight of the whole event, hopefully. We have three speakers, very high-level speakers, and each speaker will have 15 minutes, and then we have 30 minutes Q&A at the end. Shang Jin Wei will start. Shang Jin is from Columbia University. He was the chief economist of the Asian Development Bank. And I think I should mention in particular that he won the Gregory Chow Award for Best Research Paper. I don't know whether Gregory is still here, but he was here in the morning. He's probably very pleased with that. So let's just get right into that, and we will talk about debt, leverage, and everything connected to China.
Thank you, Markus. Good afternoon, everyone. Let me thank Wei and Nati for inviting me here. When Wei said, would you like to come to this conference? I said, yes, right away, thinking it's a China conference. Then I pay attention to the session title on leverage. I realized that I'm actually not working on leverage, but I'm going to try to have a paper on leverage to present. I'm going to make some comments related to that. When people are thinking about risk, associated with rising leverage in China, expressing concerns, they think about a graph like this, which is that the country's total liability as a share of GDP is rising to a level of about 260% by now. And people go, wow, isn't it very high? Certainly the rate of increase very, very fast. And this is driven especially by the corporate sector's liability. The share of GDP now reaches 160 or so percent. And more important, quantitatively more important than the other sectors. So one comment I want to say two things. One is why it's important to look at liability, the share of GDP. It's also useful to look at the other side, that there's also assets. In particular, assets is also growing very fast relative to GDP. For example, if one looks at firm level data using annual surveys of above-scale manufacturing firms, we'll see that certainly a firm level debt to asset ratio has been declining, and therefore not surprisingly, in the aggregate, we know asset to GDP has to be growing faster than liability to GDP ratio. How do we know that? Because the country's net asset is expressed in current account, and China has been running positive current account year after year in the last two decades. So that's one thing to keep in mind. Second thing to keep in mind is the structural factors. So even when we just look at the gross corporate debt, there's an important difference or pattern of divergence between state-owned firms and private sector firms. So state-owned firms, liability has been increasing, gross liability has been increasing relative to either their sales or their assets. Private firms, in fact, the numbers are improving. So the last two lines represent the leverage ratio of state-owned firms on average, private firms on average. So private firms are declining, but state-owned firms are not declining. If you look at the 90th percentile figures, private firms are getting better, but state-owned firms are increasing. And many presentations today mention the fact that state-owned firms are systematically less efficient than private-owned firms. The combination of these two facts, I think, are useful to keep in mind. One is, in the aggregate, in a very serious sense, the country doesn't have a leverage crisis. There's a way to address this, given the very high level of assets. And the other is, this divergence pattern in the corporate sector also means there's opportunities. The opportunity is that one can, in principle, make deleveraging, if deleveraging is important, and reforming state-owned sectors to go together. So they can be a complementary reforms. You can have more efficient, less leveraged the private sector firms to take over, low leveraging, more efficient private sector firms to take over more leveraged and less efficient state-owned firms. Of course, the one policy risk is reluctance of government to actually do their way, reluctance of government to let go of the state-owned firms and to continue to evergreen the loans to state-owned firms. And that reluctance will translate into the deterioration of the leverage problem suffered by state-owned firms and local governments. So that's one point. The second point is that in the looking ahead, even if one just focus on gross liabilities, the ratio of gross liabilities to GDP, whether it's sustainable or not, depends in part also on whether the country can maintain relatively healthy GDP growth. So a collapse in GDP growth is one of the ways in which the leverage problem can turn into a crisis. On the other hand, if the country can maintain healthy growth rate, you can grow out of the problem, which is sort of the things that China has been doing in the last 30 plus years. Every single year in the last plus years, I recall you go to the country, I would recall people pointing out to a set of problems. None of the problems eventually became a crisis, partly because of the relatively high growth rate. So therefore, one of the questions is, can China continue to grow? On that, we know there has been a lot of concern expressed because of moderation of the growth rate. So this is on this slide, the red line shows the growth rate of GDP, and since 2010, we see a moderation of growth rate. And this is the blue line, and the red line is the imputed growth rate of total factor productivity, and we see a collapse of the growth rate of TFP in recent years. This is a particular way of computing this. You vary some assumptions, this go up and down a little bit, but the moderation of growth rate is a concern, and there's a natural connection with the leverage discussion we are having here. To go further, since China now, when China started to reform, Chinese labor cost is ranked almost at the very bottom in the world. Not exactly the bottom, but very close to the bottom. Today, Chinese labor cost is higher than most of the non-OECD countries. So it's a very different world. By necessity, China has to change its growth model. Future growth has to depend more on productivity increase, including more innovation-based growth. The question is, can China transition to a more innovation-based growth?
On that, the answer is not obvious. If you want to look for reasons for what to say no, you can't find reasons, which is a country that's supposed to be good at copying, counterfeiting, but not so much good at innovation. So in fact, one of my engineer friends told me that his understanding is R&D in China means replication and duplication. So that's not particularly hopeful in thinking about the future R&D-driven, innovation-driven growth rate. On the other hand, if you want to look for reasons to say yes, China can transition to more innovation-based growth, why not? You can also find reasons. So WeChat, most people who are in this room, every Chinese-speaking person in the room, plus those who travel to China frequently, would have WeChat on your smartphones. In New York City, I think last year, one of the newly opened stores on Broadway was booming business. It's DJI. DJI? I don't know how many people have heard of it. DJI? So DJI is a Shenzhen-based company that produces drones for entertainment purpose. And it's extremely well made, and they made it very cheap. So now a drone that can take nice photos with very good stability properties costs less than an iPhone. So I think it'll be essentially the new future. The people at the store told me that was one of the best-selling Christmas items during the recent Christmas season. The best-selling item is called, I forgot the name, but definitely they have a backlog of several months.
In orders. Now, if you look at
So we can think about how are Chinese firms doing in terms of moving to a more innovation-based world? You can look at it in 2 weeks, 5 minutes. Okay, one is to look at on the input side, input into innovation-based world, and there you want to look at R&D spending. So on this graph, this is based on a paper I have recently done with Zhang Xiaobo and Xie Zhuan, published in the current version of a Journal of Economic Perspective. I just want to acknowledge my co-authors. On this graph, I essentially do show you two things. One is across the world, let's look at R&D spending as a share of GDP for all countries. These are blue dots. Okay, in the, I think it's 2015, I believe. Generally speaking, not surprisingly, the two are positively correlated. Richer countries tend to spend more R&D. So that's sort of think of this as international average pattern, international regularities. The dark dots around the red line are Chinese R&D spending as a share of GDP time series. From 1995 to 2014, so I'm mixing the two graphs together. The idea of this graph is to show you how China compares to international experience. So what you find is, of course, not long ago China looks like an average country. So China doesn't invest very much in R&D, but it's not surprising because China is a very poor country. Right? Over time, as Chinese GDP grows, its R&D spending, not just in absolute amount, but its a share of GDP, also grows steadily. But it does more than that. The slope, the rate of increase, is faster than what international average experience will give you. So you see a very aggressive investment in R&D in the aggregate. So that's one data pattern. Now, of course, that's just input. So what does it really mean China become more innovative? Not necessarily, because there's a separate question about whether the input can be converted into innovative output or not. So one way to look at the innovation output can be measured very different ways, but one way to look at it is to look at patterns. Patterns are not the only way to measure innovation. There are others, but it's one of the ways that for which one can get relatively good data. So there we know that Chinese patent application and patent receipt by Chinese firms in China has exploded essentially in the last few years. So much so that one of the number people love to quote is that Chinese firms now get more patents than firms from any country in the world, bar none. And that is another view often cited. Of course, they can still lead to questions. Are Chinese patents of same quality or not? Could Chinese patent authorities too generous in granting patents? So one way, we had this concern as well. So one way to investigate this possibility of whether this is entirely driven by that or not is to look at patents applied for and received by Chinese firms in the United States, compared to patents granted by the US to firms from other countries. So you just look at the patents received in the US. And again, you generally see a pattern on that score. China is no longer number one. Not too surprising, number one, the US firms. But the other thing that's very clear is that on average, firms from larger countries get more patents. Firms from richer countries find more patents. The question is, relative to those international average regularities, do Chinese firms do better or worse than this? And this graph is meant to show that, in fact, Chinese firms do very well. This is international average experience. So Chinese firm, in fact, is doing better than international average experience, and it's growing very fast. You can also look at the, academics like to look at the citation data. So there's a equivalent of a citation data for patent data. All the patents in the US, you can look at how often patent from one particular country, say from China, gets cited by patent applicants in the US from anywhere in the world. And you can look at the growth rate of the citation of patent, US patent granted to Chinese firms. You get a picture like this. I skip this slide to save time. So this shows that the innovation seems to be real. Rate of growth of innovation looks real. The last point I want to make is, that's good news. On the other hand, within the patent, within the innovation space in China, you also see very strong evidence of resource misallocation. And it shows up in the following pair of data patterns. Number one, generally speaking, government is much more generous in helping state-owned firms to do R&D, in tax subsidies and others. Number two, at the same time, state-owned firms are much less effective in turning out innovation output, even though one or two very large state-owned firms can have huge number of patents. But on balance, they are not as innovative as state-owned firms into patents received. They also are less efficient in converting a given amount of R&D expenditure into innovation outcomes. I have some graphs and tables showing that as well. Therefore, the points I made are the following. So, rising debt and to GDP ratio is something to worry about, but we need to also keep in mind rising asset to GDP ratio. Number one, number two, the diverging patterns in leverage between state-owned firm and private sector firm also means opportunities, not just risk. Opportunities of a way to do reforms that can be mutually complementary. Future GDP growth depends. In principle, the leverage ratio today is still manageable. Future growth depends on the country's ability, and Chinese firms' ability in particular, to move on to a more innovation-driven growth system. While one can think about what's wrong in Chinese firms' innovation activities, systematic look at the data says there's no reason to be overly pessimistic. The data certainly shows that when labor cost rises, it seems to be able to rise up to the challenge and become more innovative. Certainly no less than firms from other countries. And finally, nonetheless, there's tremendous amount of resource misallocation within the innovation space that the country could have done much better. Similar there, so reforming the steel sector is a common theme. They help future growth, they help innovation progress, and potentially can help with addressing the leverage problem as well. So let me stop here. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. The next speaker is Mark Spiegel. Mark Spiegel comes from the San Francisco Fed. He's vice president at the San Francisco Fed and worked mostly on international economic issues. And he's an expert who wrote recently a paper on capital controls and the Chinese monetary policy.
Thank you very much, and let me see. Thanks to the organizers for inviting me to give this paper. My intention today, since time is very limited, is to start by answering the question. So I'll be a little bit descriptive and talk about leverage issues in China, and then, time permitting, talk a little bit about a new paper that I think speaks to the issue, but it's a theory paper, so I'm going to take the strange strategy of giving you the empirical results from a theory paper and see if, and that is meant to motivate, but I won't try to drag you through the model in this very limited time. We'll see how that works. I should say that my comments are my own and not those of the Federal Reserve. So, let me start with the picture. Luckily, we've been standing on the shoulders of giants here because people have been talking about these issues all day. And here indeed is the data that shows that indeed it is the case that leverage in China has become extremely high. Here you see a picture of the non-financial debt to GDP ratio in China relative to the largest advanced economies. The Euro area, US and Japan. And you can see that during this period that a number of people earlier today identified as the Chinese credit boom, we did indeed see Chinese leverage shoot up far beyond the standards of the major advanced economies. And indeed, if you compare China's the non-financial sector's leverage position now to other emerging market economies, discrepancies are even more dramatic. China is way out there in terms of leverage. So that is a fact, and one that begs the question, you know, is this a problem and what can be done about that? So indeed, in terms of official, is there a problem?
The mic, I think, is giving some echo, so maybe just put this one away.
Okay, there we go. Yes. So, or I could stand over here, I guess, now. So, I don't trust this thing, but we'll try. So, indeed, it's officially becoming a concern. In May of last year, a so-called authoritative person was cited in the People's Daily, and Western analysts speculated that this authoritative person was very high up, said that indeed, high leverage will lead to high risk. If not well controlled, it will lead to systemic financial crisis and negative growth. And indeed, there's reason for concern. I mean, we've seen, I didn't even bother to put up the chart of how housing prices have moved, because we all know housing prices have just shot up. But there are many asset price spikes in China. We're seeing spikes in financial markets. We're seeing spikes in antiques. We're seeing spikes in art. Indeed, last year, the Wall Street Journal reported that the PVC pipe making materials prices had gone up by 40% over the course of the year. So indeed, we are seeing big. Yeah, I know this movie doesn't work. We are seeing big spikes, and so officials have moved to address the situation. And basically, because of the time I have, I'm going to limit myself to three of the ways that officials are moving to address this high leverage. First, enhancing regulatory standards. Secondly, a new program of debt equity swaps, which I'll talk about. And lastly, the PBOC's efforts to restrain credit extension. So let me start with the regulatory standards. Indeed, you can see in this picture that banks have moved to clean up their balance sheets. So this is a survey of 27 publicly listed banks, and you can see them broken down by categories here. But basically, across the board, it is the case that banks have moved to take greater charge-offs and realize that their balance sheet positions have deteriorated with deteriorating asset prices. The problem, though, is that the assets are deteriorating at the same time. So here you can see, coming out of the global financial crisis, some improvements. But since 2012, there's been a marked increase in non-performing loans. And so what we have is kind of a horse race, where the banks are increasing their rates of charge-offs on their problem debt, but the debts are getting worse at the same time. One metric that suggests that the banks aren't keeping up is to think about, in terms of charge-offs versus total lending, that's the number there, the Chinese figure is 0.67%. That's a number that's markedly smaller than the 1.06% that we have in the United States. So if you think that the Chinese banking sector is in worse shape than the US banking sector, then that suggests that their charge-offs are much less adequate than the US standard. So, but more than that, it's likely that the situation is even worse. And we talked a bit about this in a variety of presentations today, but there's two main reasons to think that the bank positions are even worse. The first is the so-called hidden loans, where banks have designated a large share of their lending activities as investment rather than straight loans. There's $2 trillion in investment receivables, and this is a big share of overall lending, and a lot of people think that by moving these assets onto non-official off the books of conventional loans, these types of loans are subject to less stringent regulatory enforcement, and that allows the perpetuation of zombie firms to exist in this more shadowy kind of context. In addition, there are so-called special mention loans. These are huge, actually, relative to the banking activity. Basically, special mention loans in China are loans that are overdue but have not yet been formally been designated
as non-performing loans. So private estimates say that, as I said, they're much bigger. So if all of the special mention loans were designated as non-performing, the NPL ratio in China would, in 2015 would go up markedly from 1.7 to 5.8%. And that would put the banks way below the mandated 150% coverage ratio, and they would be find themselves needing to raise additional capital. So the officials know this, and they've taken steps in the last year to mitigate this hidden lending and to manage these problems. The well-known document 82 that came out last year restricts these vehicles for engaging in shadow banking activity and those things, in particular the trust beneficiary rights. And basically, there's a variety of vehicles to move conventional loans off your books and into these other areas. And these comprise a big chunk, about 16% of banking loans. They also initiated guidance for reduced interbank lending, which we also talked about. But the pace at which this enforcement is going to be phased in is likely to be sluggish because of the fact that at the same time that the officials are worrying about shoring up the banking sector, they're worried about a credit crunch and maintaining an adequate pace of growth. There's this constant tension in China that's driving a lot of the type of effective regulatory responses we got. In particular, all of these, well understood that all of these types of regulatory changes, if phased in right away, would require a substantive amount of capital raising by Chinese banks. The second big program that the authorities have launched is that of debt equity swaps. And as you know, there's a risk claims, there's risk issues associated with swapping equity around. But basically, China has adopted a very ambitious debt equity swap program. The plan is to convert as much as 1 trillion RMB in debt into equity. And there are a variety of concerns about that. The program was launched as being notionally voluntary and market-oriented. And in particular, they don't want to see any government responsibility for losses. Meanwhile, the banks are selling their debt claims at face value. So it's a little bit unclear how you're supposed to square that circle, combined with the fact that the size goals are very large. So if they're going to be, 5 minutes, yeah, I'll go fast. And again, we have this zombie firm problem. So early on, meaning last year, there were two major debt equity swaps, and they were both kind of cautionary tales which shaped the policy responses this year. So first was Horong Energy. What happened there, and it was, this was 2.75 billion RMB to Bank of China. And what happened there was, of course, oil prices were going down dramatically in the early part of the year. Bank of China took a complete bath on this transaction and found itself undercapitalized and was forced to raise capital as a result of this debt equity swap. So that was a problem. The original shareholders also got their claims diluted, but primarily the burden initially was on the banks. The second big deal was Sino-Steel. There, they didn't want the banks to take as big a hit. There were more than one bank involved. So the government gave a big injection. So that helped out. And in addition, in a pattern that's been repeated in the general guidelines this year for the big program, they kind of kicked the can down the road in the sense that the conversions are only going to take place 4 years down the road. So the hope is, as Shang Jin was saying, maybe we're going to grow out of these problems. So the new regime, which is the basic guideline that they announced last month for the 1 trillion RMB, is basically the banks are not going to end up holding the equities, and the debts are going to be sold to these third agencies. There's going to be no government money up front. And there have been a number of transactions that took place already. The loans are sold by the banks at face value. And then other investors, such as the National Social Security Fund, the asset management companies, insurance companies, and even the SOEs in the deal buy shares in the fund. And then they said Consulli shares off to other investors and households. Well, clearly there's an issue, which is that who is going to bear the burden of this adjustment? And it appears to be the households that are holding equity in these funds that are investing eventually in the third management funds. And here, it all depends on if China's going to again grow out of this problem. If all goes well, the SOEs recover, they repurchase the equity stake, the owners of the funds could have a capital gain. But let's be reasonable here. They're only engaging in these debt equity swaps because there are problems associated with the initial debt claims of the banks. And so the more likely outcome is that the SOEs will not be successful, in which case the investors in the fund would suffer losses. And in particular, since they're selling the loans at face value now, these are negative net present value positions that are being taken. So the bottom line is that the burden sharing is murky. Maybe down the road, if there are losses, the government will kick in more money. But at this point, given the way the program's set up, it appears to be the households that are going to take the burden. Lastly, the PBOC's move to restrain credit. They increased repo rates. They reduced M2 growth. They recently guided tightened conditions in the financial sector, including they lowered they had lowered the reserve ratio and put it back up, but it was a temporary thing associated with Chinese New Year. So that was basically a response to an effort to inject liquidity. But in the past, the PBOC's frequently adjusted its reserve requirements. And here's where I'm getting into a recent research paper that I think talks about this issue. You can see that they adjusted it since 2005 over 40 times. Initially, they were raising reserve requirements a lot, like Kinda's paper was talking about. But more recently, the trend has been downward. They haven't really changed reserve requirements much until this Chinese New Year period this year. But in this paper, we look at how, this is a paper co-authored with Chun Cheng, Jingyi Zhang, and Zhang Lu. And basically what we argue in that paper is that reserve requirements can have these distortionary allocative implications. In particular, that because commercial banks have superior access, because state-owned enterprises have superior access to commercial bank lending, reserve requirements, which acts as basically a tax on conventional lending, acts as a disproportionate tax on SOEs in favor of private sector firms. And so what you're going to get when you change reserve requirements is you're going to get reallocation across sectors. And so we show that there's some empirical evidence in the paper. You can see here, this is just a vector autoregression where we look at a positive shock to reserve requirements. And the punchline is down here. The share of SOE investment and total investment has a decline, a negative and persistent decline showing that. And that, of course, is just macro evidence. We turn to micro evidence as well, that we look at market pricing around announcement dates of changes in reserve requirements in China. And indeed, we find that SOEs are, this is the variable of interest, they price negatively when there's an increase in reserve requirements, suggesting that state-owned enterprises are hurt disproportionately by increases in reserve requirements. And then we break up the sample to the period where shadow banking was prevalent, and we see that that's the period where the results are motivated. So in the paper that I'm not going to show you, we actually then go to town and do a two-sector BGG DSGE model that solves for optimal monetary policy and shows that in that context, optimal monetary policy can use this extra tool to achieve a superior welfare outcome than just an interest rate rule alone. But so that's all nice, but I view that as a cautionary tale in the context of the issues that we're talking about today, because it's not clear to me what this evidence shows is that these efforts, probably necessary efforts to restrain credit, are likely to have allocative implications, but it's by no means clear to me that they're being conducted in an optimal
Ramsey type of way. And so to some extent, there's a lot of scope for unintended consequences in terms of the allocation of factors and other resources from the necessary adjustments that China's currently making. So with that, I'm running out of time, so let me just conclude. The Chinese officials have realized and admitted and moved to deal with this issue of excessive credit creation, but I think it's fair to say that there's no mood for either extensive government contributions at this point or extensive movement. So there's a lot of kicking the can down the road, as I already said, in terms of the kind of mechanisms that they're setting up, where realizations will only take place farther down the road, and there's a lot of hoping against hope that high growth, or at least continued moderate growth at current paces, will mitigate part of the problems. There probably will be some capital injections required down the road from the government in terms of what they're setting up. They're not really fixing things now. They're just kind of moving chairs on the Titanic, if you will. But I would say that in terms of estimates of the overall scope of the problem, the estimated amount of the contribution relative to GDP is much smaller than the recapitalization that China, the Chinese government undertook in the previous round after the global financial crisis. So there's a problem, but it's not a nefarious problem. Thank you.
The next speaker is Joe Gyourko. He comes from our neighborhood, from Wharton, just in Philadelphia. And he's a real estate expert. He's in the real estate group at Wharton. And he's also co-director of the MBR Housing Real Estate Group. So we're looking forward to his take on the
right.
And
thank you.
Housing.
Thank you. Can you guys hear me? Am I okay? Will this
stay,
do it, or do a, do
yeah,
you?
Really? You can, if you're going to stay here, we can just turn.
I teach to. I have no slides. I teach to 100 MBAs when I teach. I'm good at projecting usually. you got to shout down the Wharton students. One, thank you very, very much for having me. A decade ago, well, a little over a decade ago, a good friend, Yong Hing Tung, who is my counterpart and the director of the real estate program at the National University of Singapore, got me interested in studying Chinese housing markets around the time the U.S. markets were tanking. And so, Wei, thank you for having me. I learned a lot today. I'll be brief since I know this is the end. And I'm going to talk about housing markets in China, not broader Chinese leverage. And I'm going to start a little bit with the U.S. I think it's always a dangerous thing, particularly for Americans, since we experienced a very sharp downturn in housing. We kind of tend to project it on to China and other countries that have had great booms. And I will certainly conclude, even if there are real problems in the Chinese housing market, it will not play out like it did in the U.S., largely because the household sector has equity in China in a way the U.S. didn't, and in a way that other parts of the U.S. financial system were also very weak. Although, given what I heard today on shadow banking and the like, I can imagine some adverse interactions of what might go on in a housing market downturn with some of that leverage. Okay, so just a little, how do I see the U.S.? Well, you start out with Mian and Sufi's work, which showed, look, the genesis, what started the problem, were the exotic loans and the, you know, essentially debt, subprime debt issued to households that were pretty risky and hadn't had a lot of income growth and the like. And we got very, very bad outcomes there. If you look ex post what happened over the cycle to some of those pools of subprime loans that got securitized, you see 40% default rates on those things. It's just god awful bad. But the price, if that was it, it would have been bad, and some investors would have lost some money, but it wasn't systemically risky, just that sector. It wasn't big enough. So when you look at what happened to us in the United States, other things had to intervene. There was a 5 percentage point increase in the home ownership rate in the United States from the start of our boom in 1995 to the roughly the peak in 05, over those years, there were 120 million households in the U.S., so every point's 1.2 million households, and you multiply by 5, and you got 6 million added households. Some of them were the households that borrowed the risky loans, and they were risky households in general, but it was a pretty big policy move across multiple governments in the U.S. to jack up the home ownership rate. And then we ran a system, a financial system, that turned out to be substantially more leveraged than I think a lot of us understood. One was our GSEs, Fannie and Freddie, who made the guarantees on conforming loans. They were running multi-trillion dollar books of business with, I think, reasonable calculations of no more than 2% equity. You just need small errors in your business plan to get wiped out there. Those guys were running 50-to-1 effective leverage rates. And then we had our own version of what I think of as shadow banks. When Bear Stearns and Lehman went down, the best estimates are their leverage ratios were 40-to-1. Again, you don't need a really big negative shock to go broke when you're running leverage ratios like that. So keep that in mind as I go forward, is a lot of things happened in the U.S. case, and it's going to lead me to conclude that in the Chinese case, even if something goes really wrong in house prices, and I think it could in a few, in some markets in China, I doubt that it's going to interact with weak finances in the household sector and in the banking sector and in the regulatory sector in the same way. So I'm certainly not going to be as pessimistic in that sense. So what about China? I can tell you a bad story. I don't think you have to be an alarmist to predict that you're going to see some mean reversion down in prices from this remarkable boom in many markets across China. Now, I actually don't think it won't start in the tier one cities. You know, we all go to Beijing, Shanghai, Shenzhen, etc., and we see these remarkable price increases, including last year in Shenzhen, where you just go, wow. So that won't continue, and certainly it might mean revert, but some other research that Yongheng Deng and Wu Jing, a co-author on other work, who is at Tsinghua, that we've done shows, we did an estimate of basically the supply-demand balance or imbalance, as it were, since the turn of the century in 35 large markets. And the really high price growth markets, the super high price growth markets, in the tier one cities, they do not look to be oversupplied at all. We can't find any metric by which they look badly oversupplied. We can find lots of markets off the coast among 35 largest cities in China, so these are not tier four cities where everyone kind of thinks something might be wrong. Today, you can find many big markets where, you know, even if you don't believe our estimates are spot on, and neither do we, by the way, it really looks like markets like Chongqing, Changsha, Xi'an, others are just oversupplied. More units got built than people moved in since the turn of the century. And that's an important warning sign for a real estate market. The reason is property is a durable good. If you overbuild a market and you get a bad negative shock from whatever source in the economy, unlike food, if you overbuild the corn market, it'll go away next year. Just leave it out for a year and it'll rot. It won't go away in property. This is why oversupply is a very dangerous thing in property markets. The good is durable. It will last for many, many years, and you have to grow your way out. So, and indeed, so there are a number of price indexes that you can go to. We produce at Wharton and the National University of Singapore and Tsinghua a land price index. Tsinghua has what I think of as a really good constant quality house price index. And over the last 3 years, Dalian is down 12% in nominal terms in that index. And if you go up what I think of as China's Rust Belt, so just keep going north in the three northern provinces there, you can find declining prices all the way up to Harbin and the like. So I think you're going to see negative performance in some of those markets, and then all you get is a negative shock, and you know, these interior markets that are oversupplied, I think will start to come down too. So why aren't I alarmed as much as maybe I should be? The answer is, and this is why I don't need all my 15 minutes, this audience knows a lot of Chinese data, because over the last 10 years, all of these cities grew by tremendous amounts. So it is true, anybody who bought in Dalian in the last 2 to 3 years is at risk. They might have close to negative equity, okay? Close. And if it gets worse, they will. But if you bought 5 to 10 years ago, almost anywhere in China, and let me say, any reasonably big city, I have Ordos and the one, you know, the poster childs for, you know, empty cities that we see on the news, they exist. But big markets, over the last 5 years, everybody has positive equity, and it would take a disastrous downturn. Now, could you conjure one up? Sure you could, but I attach pretty low probability to that. Oh, my, again, Wu Jing and one of his PhD students has a working paper now that's in progress where they use your national survey, look at the down payments people made, which are large, 20 to 30%. The ratio, you know, they're going down a little bit recently, but they're still very large by U.S. standards. And then what they do is a simulation exercise and just pro forma the slowest possible repayment rates under Chinese law, and just, you know, project out what happened based on the Tsinghua price index. And everybody, you know, who bought outside of the last 3 years has substantial positive equity. And even in declining markets, if you bought 10 years ago, your LTV is 20% today. I mean, these are really safe levels. Now, does that mean there's no risk at all? No, not at all. And this is where I think if there is a downturn in Chinese property markets, and again, all it's going to take is a negative economic shock. Smart guys like Wei will figure out what the shock's going to be. That's outside my bailiwick. But remember, when you get the negative economic shock, it's a durable goods market. If it's oversupplied, it will perform roughly like Las Vegas did. You have to grow your way out of the oversupply. What will happen in that downturn? So for me, I don't think it's going to be a bunch of defaults on the household sector. Because of that, I doubt it's going to threaten the banking sector. I don't know. You need to ask Kenda and some others about the shadow banking sector. Maybe there's stuff I don't know about those linkages. That could be. But so where would the problems be? One would be real estate developers. So in some other work that Wu Jing and I have done, over the last 5 years up until the last year, which was a good year for the builders, their inventories of vacant stuff they were holding, these are like 119 companies traded either on Hong Kong, Shenzhen, or Shanghai exchanges, they doubled. In other words, they started holding a lot of stuff. They got a little better this past year, but they're not, even if they all go broke, and some of them have what looks to me like excessive leverage, and a couple of them in foreign currency, although they're being told to change that situation. They're just not big enough to be systemically important, I don't think, okay? So unless someone in the audience goes, no, they are. So I do believe some developers will go broke, but I don't think that's the end of the world. The bigger threat, I think, is what will the household sector do in response to a meaningful decline in home equity? This is a big part of household wealth. This threatens, I think the biggest effects will be direct spillovers. They will not be in the financial sector. They will be on the real economy. So you're going to cut building a lot. Think about everybody who supplies the building industry. This will hurt the markets already weak in the Chinese Rust Belt, right? Because you got a lot of steel, a lot of coal, et cetera, in those markets. So you'll see direct spillovers there, and those spillovers will be much larger than they were in the U.S. simply because new building is much larger in China than it is in the U.S. It will also prevent the government from as quickly transitioning as it would like from its export-led growth strategy to internal consumption growth, Because once your household balance sheet gets damaged, and again, I don't think it will be nearly as bad as the U.S. case, because there's actually equity on the recent Chinese borrowers' balance sheets. Still, they have to repair their balance sheet the old-fashioned way. And the old-fashioned way is you don't spend as much as you earn. You actually save stuff, out of real income. And that means consumption growth has to stop. So as I think about what's going on, I think this could be actually have significant effects on the real side of the Chinese economy. If there's some negative shock that causes house prices to decline, it will vary a lot across Chinese markets, and I think a lot. But there are many cities that worry me because I think they are oversupplied. And for me, if I had any one wish list, it's for the Chinese government to come up with a way or to start allowing people to reflect short biases in the market. It's a way to predict. Think about one of the reasons we got so surprised in the US was it's really hard to go short against owner-occupied housing. It took some hedge funds, some funds, really a long time to think up clever ways to synthetically short the mortgage-backed securities index. One of the things I would hope China will do is learn from the fact that we were totally shocked by this. We, America, that is. Because it is such a big market, it would be nice to let people bet against it. That's viewed as un-American. I suspect it would be viewed as un-Chinese in China. But boy, as an economist, it's a way to get an early warning signal on a very, very big asset base, which, like I said, I don't think it will crash the financial system like it did in the United States, but I think it could have significant real effects. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel. So I guess everybody could perhaps come in front of for the Q&A part. Whenever I see these charts where the leverage is going up, the debt is going up, it reminds me a little bit when my brother-in-law gave me a little toy model, and there was a plane you could fly. And I was flying it. I could only fly up, but I was scared if I want to land it, it would crash down. At the end, it was going up and up and up, and I didn't really know how to bring it down. At the end, it got stuck in a tall tree, and we had to cut down the tree 2 years later. But in any case, this panel has shown that actually there's more optimism than we have seen in the previous part of the conference. And the first thing is, you know, that the asset prices go up too. But of course, if leverage goes up, asset prices typically go up. They can also go down. And we have heard a lot about how to make the debt equity swaps. That's an interesting phenomenon if that's really implemented. And then we have seen at the end the implications for the housing market. The real spillovers come really through consumption rather than through the financial system, as long as it's only the housing market. So let me open it up. If there's anybody who wants to immediately react to the other party, then allow that. Otherwise, I will just open up the Q&A to everybody.
Thank you. If I'm not mistaken, unlike the Western countries, China taxes property at the transaction level. And both the central government and local governments benefit from that. So a decline in transactions as a consequence, not just prices, but also the number of transactions, could that be another negative externality of this deleveraging?
Do you
want to
talk about that or me?
You talk about local housing?
Yeah, if you mean local property taxes, if you mean local property taxes, they basically don't exist. There's some pilots going on. So they don't get ongoing revenues. There are transactions taxes. I don't think that's going to be a huge deal. One of the things I should have mentioned was, and we talked about it in one of the earlier sessions, the other place to look for risk is in the local government financing vehicles. That stuff's collateralized right. by land. So if something goes wrong with property prices, the collateral value against a lot of that stuff is at risk. And I haven't seen really, have I missed good work on that? I don't think we know enough about that. But I don't think governments, they're much more worried about that than they are the loss of transactions taxes. And again, they don't worry about property taxes because they basically don't collect it by law.
Wait.
Well, they have to. So.
Lee?
Oh, go ahead. Yeah.
Let me, because I'm just follow up on the question on housing, so which is my favorite topic. So I fully agree with Joe's comment on household debt is not a big problem at all for Chinese housing. But on the other hand, it's 15% of the GDP. The mere fact that the sector doesn't grow is already a big problem to the whole economy, right? Because you also have to add up to the peripheral industries, then that's basically one third of the economy.
Yep.
And also the local governments sort of all rely on selling land, not property tax, because they sell directly sell land.
Yeah.
Yeah, without the land sales, then the whole thing. So that in some sense, that's the systemic part, right? So this is that's why sort of for last 2 years when the housing price started to show weakness, the government was so nervous, right? So in that sense, it's a different kind of a trouble, very different from the way it played in the U.S.
I view that as another real spillover. It's a real spillover in the governmental sector, and they rely on those revenues because, unlike cities in the U.S., they don't have local property taxes and the like by rule, so they have to get their revenues somewhere else.
Can I comment on this? Yeah. So I want to assert that. Imagine a fall in housing prices by 15%, which is pretty big, 20%, let's say, you know, how much a macro risk that is. I want to assert, in fact, it is not likely to generate a huge macro crisis. Essentially, there are three ways like, a fall in housing prices could affect macro economy.
Try this. We pretend to be on.
First is the income effect. You know, would the reduction in housing wealth lead to reduction in consumption? Second is the input-output linkages. That is the other 15%. That you know, housing construction involves buying concrete, steel, and computer houses involving buying furniture, and you can have a fall in demand for those through input-output linkages. And third is through the banking sector, right? So could the mortgage loans lead to such a big NPL problem that causing the banking sector to crash? All three are likely, but I want to suggest why they at the moment probably will not lead to a macro crisis. Let's think through those. Right? First one. The same drop in housing prices and housing wealth is unlikely to lead to the same kind of consumption response we see in the West. The reason for this is the very high savings rate. The high saving propensity lead in the past to the following pattern, that you know, 10% increase in housing prices does not give you the same kind of increase in consumption in China that we see in the West. Exact same logic would suggest that conversely, the fall in housing prices will not lead to the same kind of consumption response. One. Two, on the input-output linkages, that's real. On the other hand, China is also an economy that has a woeful shortage of affordable housing. The last government had an aggressive intention to build affordable housing. So let's talk about it by the current government, but the need is still there. And therefore, there's if there's a need to offset the input-output linkages effect of housing, the drop in the commercial housing prices, the social return to offset that by building affordable housing is sufficiently positive that you can offset those. There's room to offset that effect. And lastly, on the banking sector channel. So if we if you make a somewhat aggressive assumption that this 20% drop in housing prices lead to lead to NPL ratio, increasing NPL ratio by perhaps 6 percentage point of GDP, I think is if you think about the ratio of the loan to GDP and proportion of loans to housing sector indirectly. Now that's not a trivial number, but on the other hand, all the banking problem in the end is a fiscal problem. So the question is, can the government afford to see an increase in deficit by 6 percentage points of GDP? Yes, I think that's at the moment is yes.
Okay, I think the housing is a favorite topic of everybody. So it's also it's also a big topic of my team's research. And we have, so I certainly agree with Joe's point that the Chinese housing market, the biggest problem is oversupply. Okay, and oversupply is everywhere, including Beijing, including Shanghai.
But that's not his case.
No, not that part, the second statement is mine.
I'm not convinced.
Yeah, yeah. But, but the, so anyway, so the, we actually have a pretty big survey now. We do annual survey for Beijing government, housing survey for Beijing government. And we have lots of data over the years. We also have all the electricity, Beijing's electricity monthly data as well. And all the data kind of supporting each other. Obviously, it's not that easy, just say, not the zero usage. There's complicated stories behind. But I would say even Beijing has an oversupply problem as well. So, and the, another question, so the oversupply problem we cause, not causing in terms of the equity issues, there's no banking problem, everybody agree with that. The problem comes with potentially that those houses were put on the market. You mentioned that the housing has a big chunk of the asset, wealth. Beijing actually is 83% of your wealth, household wealth, are in housing in Beijing. And the poor household, even higher portion of the wealth in Beijing as well. So when you see that, so I think the problem is the continue. So you have a 5% job or 10% job or 20% job. If Shang Jin's point is a 20% job of housing price, it's not going to stop at 20% job. It's going to continue for the price. That's the problem. And how that problem will translate to consumption, I don't know. I don't think we understand that very much. I don't think we understand that part. Just give another example in terms of data. It's last September, where it's a peak of the Beijing's housing market, there are 46,000 houses for sale in Lianjia's website, total. All right, that's the peak of the housing market. End of October, a month later, where the housing market has cooled down in Beijing because of the new regulation has issued, from 46,000, the houses put on sale is 58,000. So it's about 24%, a quarter increase of the housing price. So I think the housing market is actually quite fragile, and that needs to be carefully monitored with lots of just not only the survey data but also lots of transaction and for sale and for sale data. So there are lots of teams in China actually are doing this type of kind of the data collection as well. Yeah. So I don't want to say too much. There's a lot to say about housing.
Yeah.
Before you go away,
your data, what's the vacancy rate?
So vacancy rate, 2 years ago, we released a vacancy of 22%, and then 22%
nationwide.
Then we have the newest data. Actually, I haven't released. We have a much careful definition about what vacant, not vacant, et cetera, et cetera. 2 years ago, the data is not as detailed as now. So it's the new definition depends on how you mark. It's about 20% actually. The 20% if we use Japan, Germany, most of European Union's definition will be 20%. If we use US definition of the vacant house, will be 18% nationwide, and that's the new number. It's higher actually. 2013 data we have something we didn't quite understand, but the 2015 data is a lot more detailed of the vacancy rate. I have people, I'm willing to share this. We haven't publicly released this number, but I think that's it's rising in a way to say
what's
that. Yeah.
That would be you said Beijing also
oversupplied. Beijing is about 20% too. Yeah.
20%
yeah.
Too?
Yeah.
What's New York?
That's based. So there's different ways. We don't want to keep doing it. But anyway.
Can I make one comment on fragility in the tier one markets? For me, the fragility, it's associated with Jim Peterba's famous, if you're a housing economist like me, famous 1984 piece on the user cost of housing in places like Beijing, Shenzhen, and the like, Shanghai, have incredibly high price to rent ratios. And they can that can be an equilibrium, but it's only stable if you believe prices are going to keep rising. If
right.
something happens to the psychology, those markets are priced to perfection, these ratios. And that to me would be the threat to the tier one markets, is that there's some negative shock that changes the psychology. But even then, if you do Wu Jing's calculations based on how much house price growth, you have to imagine the world's going to end for the typical Beijing owner to get anywhere close to negative equity. They're going to have big hits to their household balance sheet, but they're not going to look like people in Vegas in 2009. They're really not. They're going to have equity. Unless the world, and then, you know, who cares? The world's going to end.
No, that's the problem with that. There's no doubt about that part. Equity is not the problem. But the problem is how, if the wealth, you know, you think about it, so my wealth is getting down 10,000 a day. I don't know how the psychology works.
Yeah, that's fair.
That's where we don't understand. Yeah.
Should we connect? I mean, we can also go beyond housing. Just
okay, so let me take maybe half a step away from housing. So somebody mentioned something like, we all agree that the banking sector is not a problem. I just kind of want to take a step back and say maybe we shouldn't dismiss that too much. So I think I agree with Joe that it's not as severe as it, so there's going to be a question after this one, that it's not maybe as severe as it was in the US, just because the shadow banking sector is not as reliant on mortgages and mortgage repayments as we saw in the US. However, if you look at trust company data, about a quarter of trust company loans go to real estate and property, which means that, I mean, so if you think about shadow banking, it's banking in the sense of being maturity mismatched, and you don't need a big shock in order to trigger a run. So if you look at reserve primary, in the US, the run on money market mutual funds, there was a run after Lehman defaulted, but reserve primary wasn't holding that much Lehman debt. So even a small shock can trigger a run when you have the sort of diamond dipic transformation. So in kind of absolute terms, the shadow banking sector isn't gonna be as dependent on the housing market, but you don't really need it to be that dependent in order for a change in expectation. So I mean, I don't know it's not so much a question as to say maybe we want to think about the banking sector a little bit more seriously in this, and if somebody wanted to pick up on that.
Can I ask you a question? Sure. Which is, so in the US, one of the Lehman and Bear problems was the duration match of borrowing so short. They were so dependent on the overnight market, and they go out and buy land, which is as illiquid as you can get. So is there any evidence there's that type of deliberate duration mismatch across the asset and liability sides of the balance sheet that we saw in our investment banks before the two went under?
So, I mean, it's not as bad as that. The median maturity of wealth management products is 3 months. There was a period of time when it went down to 1 month when the regulator was monitoring end-of-month loan-to-deposit ratios. You saw amongst the smaller banks 1 month maturity. But now we're back up to 3 months. Trust company loans, I mean, maybe are on the order of 2 years. So it's not as bad as it was in the US. Now, in the interbank market, I mean, so some of the stuff is feeding through the interbank market, and that's shorter term. But I don't think there's any bank that is, in the way that Lehman was, relying on overnight repos to finance super long-term stuff.
Can I just object some question? How does the mortgage market look like in China? Is it floating, or is it fixed, or is it like in the US?
No, it's floating.
So you can push the losses onto the house. I mean, if this it goes up,
it's floating.
Cool and
down payments are and it's until very recently you had to put 30% the rule of the government, I think,
right.
Wei's right, the government got nervous, they lowered the down payment ratios a bit, but there's substantial equity at purchase in China.
So in response to Marcus' encouragement, I'll take a full step away from housing. Since Professor Wei mentioned about innovation and patents in China, My understanding is that the citation, the information on citation in China is very limited. So I think it's valid to use patents applied in the States, Chinese patents applied in the States and being cited. But do we worry about certain biases being introduced in that process? And just going forward, are there efforts to make proper measurements or other alternative metrics for measuring innovation in China?
So that's a...
Can you turn it off, please?
Yes, there will be a great direction to do research. When I ask people, what are the dimensions of innovation you want to look at? People say, oh, innovation, besides patent, you have commercial secrets, you have business models, and that's one area people often stress, that Chinese firms, those innovative firms, seems to be especially innovative in coming up with new way of new business models, but those things are very hard to capture. So I don't know how to capture yet. So I think there's great opportunity for good research on that.
We can even go beyond patents and housing and the shadow banking system. Any more questions? I guess you get back to housing.
it is perhaps connected to housing, but I didn't hear anyone, actually, this is not just a panel, but nobody talked about demographics.
That's a big problem. Yeah.
And I wonder if you have it, it's related to housing as well, and that's sort of on a longer run level, it's a shift that we need to think about. So anyone, I guess, not just the panelists, but anyone in the audience who has a specialty here can answer that.
For sure. I think it's a bit longer run in China. And the reason is there's still some labor in the rural areas. So even though the aggregate is there's enough in the short run that you can migrate into the cities to provide labor. So. But yeah, in the medium term, 5 years out plus, yeah, I think you'll start seeing demographic factors start to play out in different cities in China, absolutely. But not immediately.
So let me add something to the migration, because some of the findings we have is the 1.3% migration rate from rural to urban every year, more than half of them, which are not the truly migrants. So I call that the redefined migrants. So they actually never moved, never changed their location. Their area is reclassified as an urban area. And then after reclassification, they become urban residents, become part of the migrations. And they brought houses into urban area. That's why when people question they're using incremental versus incremental, it didn't work, because the big chunk of the migration are not real migrants, so just want to add that point. That's something we found, and very few people are talking about that point.
There's also a group at Tsinghua studying that demographic thing now and how it's going to play out in housing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say there are comparative studies of China and Japan, and finding them on very close trajectories based on demographics, and they're just behind. And basically what the projection is going to be that the kinds of growth values that they're considering as reasonable growth rates going forward may well not be attainable 5 to 10 years down the road. And that's just a reality of the situation.
There are actually three aspects of demographics that may be housing market relevant. One is the growth of the population, and Chinese, at least working age cohort, has turned to negative growth rate since about three years ago. The second is internal migration. Then you move out of rural area to cities where you need to have city dwellings. That's the second. The third is gender racial imbalance, that I have a paper forthcoming that argue that gender racial imbalance is one of the contributors to housing prices anywhere, but Chinese data provides a very way to demonstrate that. The recent the thing I want to add on this is that we estimate something like 20% of the housing
price increase could be linked to that factor. The recent relaxation of family planning policy, recent meaning end of 2015, allowing more families to have more children, ironically will improve the generation imbalance, actually will lead to potentially less strong desire to buy housing as a status good. You buy housing for other reasons, but less strong desire to buy housing as a status good. But it will not improve age structure. It will not improve. Will not improve the dependence ratio. So the dependence ratio, in fact, will get worse when you relax the family planning policy in the short run. No one can produce 20-year-old. So you can only produce babies, right? So there are three different channels through which demographics could affect the housing prices.
Okay, one right over there.
This is near the end of the, I want to use the few minutes to ask a general question. I think in the last 2 days, I want you to reflect on, we have learned a great deal about China. Can you tell us from all these exchanges what we can do for the United States? I mean, you view all these projections give us the impression that we are perfect. And all the measures are measured relative to what United States is doing. From all your method, your policy, your analysis, is there nothing we can learn from what China has done so that we can do something?
Yeah, have equity in your housing system either on the borrower or the lender side, preferably both. That to me, as I study housing, is the lesson from China. It's why I think there will not be a disaster, even from a significant house price decline. We did it wrong. We tried to run it with no equity. The reason we did that is equity's expensive. So we tried to fake it. It's a very bad idea.
But we go away from housing. Go to the
I don't know anybody except housing. These guys tell you not to.
I know the U.S. was going to build a Great Wall. I know some countries that have experienced it.
That's
all
right. Essentially, we need more equity, less debt. I think this also is consistent with the debt-equity swap we have heard earlier.
I don't think they can hear you.
Is it working? Yeah. I switched it on.
This
try this.
Try this.
Let me say it again.
Is it working now?
Yes.
So let's conclude with that. Let's conclude we need more equity instead of debt. And we also saw earlier, you know, the debt equity swap might be one way to go if it's designed properly and not just pushing the can down the road. I guess we had a great conference. I think probably Atif, do you want to say some final words? Or
thank you.
I would like to thank all of you who came here and who hanged out to the end. That's a special achievement. I would also like to thank Atif, Violetta, Nancy, and Wei for putting this whole thing together. I think that's, let me take on the task to thank everybody. And let's give a big round of applause to the organizers as well.